My talk today will be about the diagnosis of osteoporosis by traditional methods and going through the future by newer approaches. Where are we today in the diagnosis of osteoporosis? We have definite risk factors, which are well documented and independent from BMD. We have the BMD, which is the reference standard for diagnosis of osteoporosis, and also considered as additional risk option for risk assessment. We have the lab turnover markers, which also additional option for risk assessment. We have different types of techniques to measure the BMD, starting from the traditional methods, conventional radiography, radiographic absorptiometry, ultrasound, and DEXA, to the non-traditional methods, new DEXA techniques, quantitative CT, finite element analysis, and MRI. What about the radiographic assessment of bone density? To depend on the conventional X-ray for the diagnosis of osteoporosis, the patient should lose about 30% of his bone content to visualize transradiant or transparent bone. So it is not wise to depend on conventional X-ray and plain X-rays to diagnose osteoporosis, because you will diagnose it very late. But we have certain considerations during the examination. The end plates should be parallel and not biconcave like that. The distance should be 100 centimeters, and we avoid overlap between vertebrae. The grading are measured according to the degree of loss of height of the vertebrae. Grade 1 from 20 to 25% loss of height, more than 25 up to 40% is grade 2, and then the last and third degree, which is loss of more than 40% of the height of the vertebrae. Now we go to the standard DEXA technique. What about the DEXA technique? It is site-specific measurement. We can measure every site separately. It is essential for prediction of BMD, fracture risk, and rate of bone loss. It can evaluate the lumbar spine, proximal femur, forearm, and total body bone, which is important in children and certain metabolic bone diseases and severe osteoporosis. It is an X-ray dependent machine of high intensity beam, fast scan, low dose of X-ray, high image quality, excellent precision. We'll talk about precision later on. Can measure all skeletal sites, central and peripheral, and it is of best clinical utility. It can measure the bone mineral content in grams. Bone mineral contents means bone mineral density multiplied by the area. And bone mineral density, which is the most important item, it means density in gram per centimeter square. We can, by the use of DEXA, we can determine the bone tissue, bone mineral density, bone mass, and area, and also we can measure the soft tissue surrounding the bone. How to express the BMD? We express it in T and Z score. The difference between the patient's score and norm, which are T score or Z score, is expressed in standard deviation above or below the mean. Usually, one standard deviation equals about 10 to 12% difference in bone density. In general, when we are talking about fracture risk, we talk in terms of T score. T-score is used because fracture risk increases as BMD declines from young normal levels. Here is the young normal level in 20 years of age, and then we start losing. We have a peak or plateau here, extending from 20 to 40, around 40, and then we start to decline. The bone density starts to decline with age downhill. So the T-score is comparison between the patient BMD and the peak bone mass at about 30 years of age. Because in older adults, low BMD is very common. Comparison with age-matched levels can be misleading. So this is an example of patient. The bone density of the patient in 20 years of old, here, the T score of him is minus 2.5. He's away from the peak by minus 2.5. And when he is 60 years of old, of age, with the same density, he is only minus 1 of the Z score because he is, it is compared to a low density at the same age. About T-score, the advantages of using T-score and not using absolute number of bone density, it is unitless, it is the basis of the majority of osteoporosis guidelines, and it is simple. But it has its own disadvantages. It depends on the site measures, depends on technology, depends on reference database or population, mean, and standard deviation. It only includes BMD information and not additional risk factors. So for any particular test, for example, DEXA of the spine, the T and Z score can be directly translated into percentages of young normal or age-matched values. Thus, for lumbar spine BMD by DEXA, one standard deviation equals about 12%. A T-score of minus 2.5 is the same as BMD value 30% below the average value in young adult. This is an example of a patient here at 20 years old with bone density corresponds to T-score minus 1.5, and at the same, this young age, the Z-score is also minus 2.5. But if we have a patient 61 years of age, the T-score is minus 2.5 here, while the Z-score is almost normal because he matches with his age group. The bone density measurements, we have four diagnostic categories following the WHO categorization. The T-score is normal BMD, is considered up to minus 1 standard deviation of the T-score, osteopenia from minus 1 to minus 2.5, osteoporosis less than minus 2.5, and severe osteoporosis if it is associated with fragility fracture. We have different size to measure. The most common is the AP spine. Also, we measure the femoral neck. We can have comparison between dual femurs and the forearm, and as well as the whole body in children and certain metabolic diseases. We can determine the bone loss, assist in the diagnosis of osteoporosis, support the treatment decision, because we decide the start of treatment according to the T-score measurement, monitor treatment response, and enhance patient therapy compliance. This is very important because the patient, when he feels that he is gaining bone, by the according to the DEXA measurements, his compliance to the medicine increases. The X-ray dose is minimal of DEXA is minimal. If we compare it to the natural dose for 1 year, the epidexa is 0.03%. If we compare this very minor X-ray irradiation dose, which the patient gets with DEXA, with the lateral X-ray spine film, conventional X-ray film, which we can get 90% of the natural dose of 1 year. So the difference is very high, and DEXA is very safe and allows very minimal amount of irradiation. But we have problems with the interpretation of DEXA because other conditions may give the same low bone mineral density like osteomalacia. We cannot differentiate between osteomalacia and osteoporosis by DEXA because both of them produce low bone mineral densities. We also got different diseases that can falsely increase the bone mineral density, like osteoarthritis. If the patient have got osteoarthritis and osteoporosis, so the BMD will falsely be high because of the osteophytic projections and new bone formations and the sclerosis associating osteoarthritis, which may cause false high normal or high densities measured even if the patient is osteoporotic. Also vascular calcifications, especially in this around anterior to the spine, the abdominal aorta get calcifications with old age, atherosclerotic calcification, and this also affects the measurements of the spine density and cause false increase in BMD. Overlying metal objects, contrast media, if the patient had recent contrast media barium examination, for example, or IVP with intravenous contrast inside his body, and we measure the BMD at that time, it will give false increase in density. Previous fractures for the same reason, callus formation, severe scoliosis also causes false high positive or high densities, vertebral deformities. All such problems may reduce the bone density or increase the bone density falsely. Examples for this, this metal causes increase in bone density, so we cannot measure the spine density in such patient. Like this also, here, metals. Scoliosis and new bone formation causes high density, which is false, of course, because the same patient has low bone density in the femur, minus 2.2. So it is wise when we get a false high density in one site to omit it and rely on the other lower density site. So where are we going tomorrow? We have new techniques that may help measure components of bone quality and how they contribute to bone strength. Bone strength is not dependent only on bone density. We have other collaborating factors, which we call it bone quality. We have now specialized DEXA technique, like the lateral vertebral morphometry, advanced hip assessment, and we have new regions of interest to be measured by DEXA. This by DEXA, now we, by other techniques, quantitative CT, finite element analysis, high resolution MRI and MR spectroscopy. I will go fast through these points just to illustrate what is happening in the future. We have a specialized application for DEXA, the vertebral fracture analysis, advanced hip assessment, new regions of interest for vertebral fracture analysis. We have to analyze the length, the height of the vertebrae, because for both women and men, a prior vertebral fracture is a strong independent risk factor for future vertebral and non-vertebral fractures. Women with vertebral fractures have a five-fold increased risk of a new vertebral fracture and a two-fold increased risk of hip fracture. Lateral DEXA morphometry is a relatively new DEXA technique has been developed to evaluate vertebral deformity using a lateral DEXA scan of the spine from T4 to L4. Compared with radiograph, this technique is potentially advantageous with lower cost and lower radiation exposure because it is quick and can be done in the same visit of BMD measurements. Here is the vertebral morphometry examination showing how we can delineate every vertebral body and detect the degree of wedging and compare it with the next examinations. How to measure it? We measure it through three axes at the anterior, middle, and posterior, and then measure each one and compare it with the vertebra above and below and see what is the percentage of reduction in the height in every part. And then compare the patient with himself in the next coming follow-up examination. Here is an example of wedging, and this is the how to we stage the degree, whether we have wedging by concavity or compression. Changes in vertebral height of the same vertebral body from a baseline radiograph. A loss of 15 to 20% in anterior, middle, or posterior heights in a vertebra that was normal at baseline. Now we go to the next step of advances, which is advanced hip assessment. It includes all the standard femoral regions. In addition, it provides the measurements of two new regions of interest, which is the upper and lower femoral neck, automated determination of hip axis length and hip strength values. This is very important to detect which patient is amenable to get a hip fracture in the future, lateral neck fracture hip. We have new regions of interest by DEXA. We can measure the mandible, which assists very much the dentists in implantation and deciding whether the implant will succeed or not. This is a very big growing space in the work because, as you know, the implantation failure is about 30%, and it depends mainly on the degree of or the healthiness of the bone. which the dentist implant in. Also, we have the hand bone density, which is very important for rheumatology. This is the hand bone density assessment measurements. The enhanced image resolution afforded by DEXA suggests that this technology may be of benefit to monitor the impact of diseases such as rheumatoid arthritis on hand, joint space, and or bone mineral density around the joint of the hand. As you know, there is juxta-articular osteoporosis and rheumatoid arthritis, and by this we can detect it early and measure its progression, thus allowing monitoring of disease progression. Also, with the orthopedic development of prostheses, we can now measure bone around prostheses and detect early loosening. Also, bone around the prostheses, the femoral prostheses. Now we go to monitoring. What is the importance of monitoring and how to monitor the bone density? Why we monitor therapy? Will the results of repeat DEXA scan change your management? If a repeat DEXA scan is ordered, how do you know if the change is real? These are very important questions. Many factors affect the accuracy of BMD testing, including inter-machine variants. Therefore, any repeat DEXA ideally should be with the same machine, because all testing methods have variations in successive measurements due to random fluctuations. A statistically significant change in BMD must exceed the expected test-to-test variation. This statistically significant amount is referred to as the least significant change, or the smallest detectable difference. What is the least significant change? It depends on the precision error of the machine, and it depends on desired confidence level. So it means that it equals 2.8 multiplied by the precision error of the machine. Only changes exceeding 2.8 times the precision error can be considered clinically significant within the 95% confidence interval. I will try to simplify this. Precision is important because it allows the least significant change to be calculated. You need to have a very precise test in order to detect minor changes which are significant, minor changes under the effect of treatment. If you don't have a very precise test, you will not pick any, you will not get the significant change, or you will not be confident if this change in BMD is true or is this false due to bias in the measurements. So you have to get a precise measure. What is precision error? Precision error reflects the reproducibility of a measurement when performed under identical circumstances in the setting of no real biological change. If you compare these two charts, this is precise. Maybe not so accurate, but this is precise. This one is not precise, although some of the tests are more accurate. So in BMD, we need precise measurements. No difference between repeated tests, because any minor difference should be due to the treatment and not due to an error in the machine or in the test. Spine BMD with anti-resorptive agents, we get about 2% least significant change. And in the femur, the least significant change is also measured here. So to clarify this point, if we have the precision, very, very good precision of a machine of about 1% difference between an examination and its follow-up, to be confident that the result of this treatment is okay or is significant, we have to get a difference of about 2.5% in BMD between the two measurements, because there is a rule of the precision, the least significant change is 2.5 multiplied by the precision of your machine. And the best machine now, its precision is about 1%. Many factors that are not clinically apparent could lead to suboptimal response to therapy. Long-term compliance and persistence with therapy is poor. Only about 50% of patients who begin an osteoporosis drug continue therapy for at least 1 year. Some patients do not maintain a sufficient intake of calcium or vitamin D to achieve the full benefit of therapy. Also, malabsorption caused by a variety of GIT disorders, including asymptomatic celiac disease, may impair treatment effect. Other conditions with adverse skeletal effects, such as multiple myeloma or increased thyroid hormone levels, may be present but undetected before therapy or may develop during therapy. That's why we have to do follow-up under treatment. Various circumstances may affect decisions about continuing or modifying treatments. The prognosis, responsiveness to treatment, possibility of changing to a less obstructive or lower risk intervention, resident satisfaction with the benefits of or concern about complications related to treatment. Now we go to the ultrasound assessment of bone. The most common of it is the measurements of the bone of the calcaneus. Other sites are the phalanges of the hands. What is measured by quantitative ultrasound? In ultrasound, we don't measure the BMD like in DEXA, but we measure something called the broadband ultrasound attenuation, ultrasound velocity through bone, ultrasound attenuation in bone. All these three parameters are significantly associated with bone structure, independent of BMD, or bone mineral density. They depend on the structure of the bone, the way of architecture, the way of the trabeculae are arranged, the density of the trabeculae, but not the bone density. Ultrasound velocity in bone is largely influenced by trabecular separation, ultrasound attenuation by connectivity, ultrasound broadband, ultrasound attenuation by combination of both, the trabecular separation and the connectivity. So all quantitative ultrasound parameters are associated with microarchitecture of bone rather than bone density alone. It provides information about bone quality that is partly reflected by BMD. It can separate patients with high fracture risk from those with low risk. However, it is not ideal for follow-up. This slide shows that it is many studies prove that ultrasound is not ideal for follow-up, but it can detect high-risk patients for fracture from low risk. Now, a focus on bone quality. What is bone quality? High BMD alone does not protect from fracture if quality is impaired. An example of that in fluorosis, fluoride and osteopetrosis, we get high bone mineral density, but high fracture risk. Increase in BMD with anti-resorptives underestimates observed decrease in vertebral fracture risk. Reductions in fracture risk with anti-resorptives occur early, before maximum BMD gains. Persons on steroids treatment fracture more at the same BMD with persons without steroids. So it is not the problem only of BMD. We have another problem, which is the structure or quality. Older persons fracture more at the same BMD. Recently, osteoporosis is defined as disorder characterized by enhanced skeletal fragility due to reduction in both bone quality and quantity. Bone quality is the most important predictor of fracture risk. Bone quality may be defined as the set of structural variables of the skeleton, not measurable by DEXA, having an influence on its strength. DEXA gives us an estimate of the amount of mineral tissue in bone. Other factor influencing bone strength is the way that the bone tissue is arranged in its tri-dimensional space, which we call it the bone microstructure. The bone microstructure, this is what is called bone quality, and this is the focus of future measurements of bone or assessment of bone, the microstructure of the bone, and not only the amount of bone mineral content. Rapid deterioration of microarchitecture parameters increase amount of bone, resulting in decreased bone volume, trabecular status, the number is diminished, and the separation is increased, and the porosity is increased. How to measure the trabecular bone or to assess the trabeculae of the bone. Here is the quantitative CT assessment of bone. We can separate the trabecular bone alone and leave the cortical outline and assess only the center of the vertebra. Here is 3D, evaluates bone geometry and cancellous and cortical bone density. We can measure only the center of the bone, trabecular bone, not like DEXA. DEXA measure all the bone density of the whole vertebra. But here we can separate the trabecular bone, and also here we can separate the trabecular bone in the femoral neck. This is important in evaluating the follow-up in patients under treatment. Quantitative CT, it is flexible measurements. We can measure pure trabecular bone or mix of both. Advantages, it has high radiation. Disadvantages, it's high radiation dose compared to DEXA. It is lower precision and expensive. We have something called peripheral CT. You can measure only the forearm or leg. Here is high resolution peripheral quantitative CT. See how we can see the trabeculae, the number and the degree of separation, and follow up the patient independent on the bone density. Another image showing the normal trabeculae and how it looks in osteoporosis. By this, we can follow up the patient under treatment and see how he can build up the trabeculae again. Its strength is a 3D assessment of architecture. It's short time, of course, low radiation. The peripheral is low radiation. And age-related changes and fracture discrimination studies really exist. But its limitation is limited to radius and tibia only, the peripheral skeleton, requires specialized equipment, no prospective fracture data until now, limited reference. What about a future, another future diagnostic part called the finite element analysis? It predicts bone strengths. It can determine which part of the bone is stronger and can. It is an analytical method to predict bone strengths that integrates material and structural information. It mixes both the bone mineral density and the architectural structure of the bone. Uses quantitative CT imaging data for geometry and density. So it is a new approach mixing the density and the structure or geometry. What about the role of MRI in the future? We have new technique called the magnetic resonance microscopy. It is high resolution images provides information about trabecular microarchitecture. And we have also something else called MR spectroscopy of bone marrow. It provides information about bone marrow chemical composition. So this is imaging, shows the trabecular microarchitecture, but this is chemistry. It shows chemical composition. The microscopy, it looks like the CT microscopy. It allows a visualization of the trabeculae, their number and their separation. Another example of micro MRI. Its strength, it is non-invasive, no ionizing radiation. It is 3D assessment of cortical and trabecular. Clinical scanners can be adapted. We can change any machine and add the software of this on it. Treatment-related effects, it can visualize the changes in the trabeculae after treatment, but its limitation, it is limited to the appendicular skeleton, limited reference data, and technically demanding. Lastly, the MR spectroscopy of bone marrow. It is a new technique. It can evaluate bone marrow fat non-invasively and serially. Many researchers have shown that the majority of subjects with weakened vertebrae have a high percentage of bone marrow fat fraction. So the bone marrow changes into fat in osteoporotic bone. MR spectroscopy of bone marrow divides the global MR signal from bone into two major segments, water and fat and lipid. Water signals comes mostly from the red marrow. Most lipids stem from yellow marrow. The spectra of MR spectroscopy have a water peak and the lipid peak. To simplify things, this is the normal peaks coming from the normal bone marrow. We have two peaks. Water peak should be high because it reflects or shows the red marrow. And fat peak or lipid peak it corresponds to yellow marrow. In osteoporosis, we get increase in yellow marrow and reduction in red marrow. This is the normal. We have a first peak higher. This is a normal patient. His DEXA is normal. And he has a very high water peak and low fat peak. This is the normal bone marrow chemistry. Here in osteopenia, the patient here, in his DEXA is osteopenic, and we get increase in fat peak being almost equal or higher, slightly higher than the water peak. This is the intermediate degree osteopenia. In osteoporosis, we get reduction in the water peak and increase in fat peak, and here is the patient by DEXA is osteoporotic. And in severe cases with compression, we have an escalating very high fat peak and low water peak. This is spectroscopy. This is how to examine the chemistry of bone marrow. And of course, the effect of treatment will be marvelous by seeing what will happen in the chemistry of bone under treatment. To conclude, BMD tests are safe, painless, and non-invasive tests which evaluate bone density, a measure of bone strength. Bone quality is another important factor involving osteoporotic fractures. New techniques are now developing in order to assess this factor and to evaluate the effect of treatment measures. New technologies in DEXA with improved image resolution is now used to evaluate small joints, bone around orthopedic implants, and vertebral fracture risk assessment. High-resolution peripheral quantitative CT, finite element analysis provide better assessment of architecture and density. Micro and high-resolution MRI, MR spectroscopy also evaluate bone trabeculae and bone marrow chemical composition. These new techniques aim to enhance care of patients and prevent osteoporotic complications. The strategy of monitoring therapy with BMD testing is supported by the medical evidence consistent with the clinical practice guidelines and makes good clinical sense. Thank you very much.